Hello and welcome to this podcast. Today it is my pleasure to welcome Thomas Noppen to shed a light on the importance of media freedom from the point of view of a journalist and news entrepreneur. Thomas is a board member and previous chair of News Media Denmark, an organization which he founded to create a unified political voice for small and medium-sized digital and innovative media publications in Denmark. His journalistic experience ranges from hosting a weekend show on Danish national radio to founding and managing an online newspaper before editing a printed design magazine. At a European level, he's part of the steering committee at the European Innovative Media Publishers, EIMP. That was a long bio because you do a lot of things. So, Thomas, you know about our 3+1 format. You get three questions and one soapbox moment. And I know you're nervous about the soapbox moment, but it'll be fine. Let's start with question one. What does protecting media freedom mean to you? And I know that the reaction usually is, well, I could write a thesis on that, but you only have 5 minutes, I'm afraid.
No problem. I'll keep it short. And thanks for having me here. It's a real pleasure to be asked to join. Mean to me? Well, I think obviously different countries have different challenges. And in some countries, the very freedom of the press is much more challenged than it is, say, in Denmark. So I'll leave speaking of that to others and speak about more of the Danish perspective. And I think actually, for us or for my organization, it's about the freedom to pursue the journalism that is needed today. And I think in terms of need is not something universal. Some publishers have one way of doing things and new ones have others. So publishing takes many shapes, but there's a tendency to favor what we can call the known quantity. But, you know, like what worked yesterday might not work tomorrow. And media freedom, in my opinion, should be about ensuring that we don't put systems in place that favor and institutionalize certain ways of being a publisher. So I think there's a tendency to define media freedom, let's say actually like financial freedom, by where legislation favors old legacy publishers who have one way of doing it. And in with that happens that like they forget the new ideas and the new needs of journalism.
That's actually a good point in the sense that often legislators legislate what they know and they can't anticipate what they don't know yet. And I often joke by saying if they could anticipate, they would probably be venture capitalists and not legislators. But it is a fault that happens in many files, not just media freedom. So if I think with that vision of trying to think of all models and not just a few, what should the EU legislators do or do better to protect media freedom?
Well, I think they should they shouldn't let the old guard define what media freedom is. There is a plurality of people who should be heard. There's experts, there's startups, and really they should listen much more to their opinions as well. Because those opinions might differ significantly from legacy publishers. And although it's much easier to hear what legacy publishers have to say because they have, well, obviously they dominate the debate because they are the news, but they also have the financial powers to actually put in the lobbying efforts, which a lot of small publishers don't. So I definitely think that. And then also, legislators shouldn't get too blindsided by the discourse about the tech platforms being the main problem. This is a point I've tried to make a few times in Denmark as well, that you know, media legislation is only 10% tech platforms. There's a lot of other stuff which is much more important, but because of some publishers, old publishers again, losing some revenue to some new businesses who do, you know, they actually help some platforms getting traffic, but they do something completely different. They are made to get advertising revenue, and some publishers have lost that revenue. But media freedom and like the possibilities to create a media business aren't that dependent on tech platforms. Certainly they're not the main problem. I think that legislators should really focus on what are the challenges of media rather than what are the challenges of old media vis-a-vis the tech giants. And then there's a third thing, is that legislators should focus on journalism and not the medium. We know that journalism can take many shapes, there's TV, writing, etc. And we don't know what will be the next big thing. Right now it's audio, but audio is certainly growing big. Like print online is still big, but we don't know what it is. So don't make legislation that purely focuses on one type, because it might change tomorrow. And there might be startups which can, you know, really change the landscape, but who are disenfranchised or somehow rather like out competitive, can't compete because there's legislation that favors one way of doing it in place of something else.
Okay, I think to a certain extent you've already raised part of that question, response to question three, which is what are the pitfalls that EU legislators should avoid when trying to protect the media and our freedoms, in the sense that you raise a technological neutral approach to a certain, or a platform neutral approach, or distribution channel neutral approach in your previous answer. But maybe there's other pitfalls that you see that they should beware of.
Yeah, well, they're basically all connected, but there is this part about like not making laws for now and yesterday, but make laws that like cover your bases in the future. So we don't have like legislation which is like specific for one type of situation or one type of problem. And in this particular context, like a really bad example is the copyright directive, which was made to put some pressure on YouTube somehow, but basically now make sure that YouTube is the only possible channel, or what we call it, who can actually follow that legislation. So they've basically given YouTube a monopoly, which wasn't the intention. And I know a lot of experts actually warned about this, but I think it's really important for legislators to listen to the criticism and pitfalls about this, because this is the perfect bad example of actually supporting something where your intention was completely different. That can actually come over to my second recommendation, which is don't make laws that protect, but make laws that empower. It's again back to the discussion about protecting one type of publisher or one type of doing business. And what we really need is something that levels the playing field, so what can come forward actually has the opportunity to do it. So you need to create a path or opportunity for media publishers to do something new, something that is needed. So that actually just ties into the third recommendation, is that you should support ideas and not business models, because there's the best journalistic businesses and publishers, they come from the heart. They come from people wanting to tell stories in a different way, to challenge the people in power in different ways, and they're born out of a need to do it. But business models of the old days, you know, you have tons of employees, etc., and you're protecting the business, not the journalism you're doing, but the business. So legislators should really focus on giving opportunities to create support the ideas, because that is actually what allows us to have a proper and good public debate across the entire European Union and beyond.
That is actually a very good one. I think the protecting the ideas and empowering companies and innovative models, rather than looking at just keeping a status quo to a certain extent, which a lot of the legislation does, is it basically crystallizes the position of existing players. Your moment of stress, Thomas. The soapbox moment. There's two lovely ladies looking at you, Ursula and Roberta, who lead respectively the Commission and the Parliament in Brussels. And you have 2 minutes to deliver a message to them in terms of what you think would be useful that they do. And, you know, you only have the weight of all of innovative news media publishers in Denmark on your shoulders. So that should be easy. I'll give you your 2 minutes.
All right. I think like the most important thing to do is to ensure that there is a healthy public discourse debate across the entire European Union. And the way to do that is to have a plurality of options in the media. So, you know, there's to get people engaged in society, some people like this type of news, some people like that type of news. And what lets them engage with the news is that they are offerings that actually are, you know, tasteful to them. Some people like watching things on video, some people like listening to the news, some people like reading it. But the most important thing is that there isn't just like a uniformity, one type of media publisher out there, but that there are many perspectives. And the most important task for a legislator in Europe is to ensure that there is a breadth, multiple multiple options in the media landscape, so people can engage at every level and at different cost levels. And I think that's like the main task: make sure that there's a lot of choice and different choices.
Okay, I think choice is usually what the Commission and the European Parliament say they want to achieve for users. So that should ring a bell in a positive sense, I think, with both institutions and hopefully also the Council. Thank you so much for your time today on this podcast. Thank you for bringing, I think, a practical experience that has also the perspective of the Danish environment, which, as you said in your introduction, every environment is different on media. So I think it's important to get as many views as possible from different geographies and from different cultures of media. I'm sure that we will be discussing acts like the Media Freedom Act that will be upcoming soon. And I hope that the Commission will hear your plea to listen to as many voices as possible to make sure that it's not just a few that are represented in Brussels. Thank you, Thomas. And I think we will still be discussing this in the next months, and who knows, maybe on another podcast.
Thank you, Caroline. Thank you. Pleasure to be on.